I find the reverse at home?
No, only myself. Mm-hmm, yes, that's right. Later, I have like one set of tapes. I just click it in whenever I want it. Are you in production right now, or are you?
No.
No, not yet.
No.
Okay.
I mean, I'm constantly producing something, but it's right now it's just bad mood and stuff like that.
Do you feel like you've had enough time off? And you've now been an American movie star for 6 years.
Yeah, no, but first of all, I'm not a victim. Nobody forces me to do anything. I do it voluntarily. I like to do it, and I'm happy. Mm. I don't really see a reason why I should now create a problem, you know, that makes me more interesting.
There's no downside?
No.
Because I actually, the first time we chatted, I think, was right before you won an Oscar for Inglorious Basterds. And I think you told a story at that point that you'd been advised before you came here, or years before you decided to come and do American films, that if you came to Hollywood, they would make you into a villain, and that's all you would ever get to play.
Yeah. That was Walter Kona, who said that to me. Look, it's. I don't really look at the parts from that perspective. I try to make it a lot more fun and interesting for myself. Mm-hmm. And because really, what would I do when I say, okay, this is a really bad guy, this is so bad, now I play really bad. How do you do that?
I've never seen that performance from you. That would be interesting.
I've never seen it. Well, I'm not so sure whether I've never seen it. To some degree, I might have, but I totally concur in that I'm not interested either.
So Walter's kind of it seems to me, aside from the Quentin roles, kind of the most, and even really with the Quentin roles, like the most rangy character that you've had a chance to play in American cinema.
I agree. It's really a beautiful part. It's because it's in a way, you know, if you detach yourself from the morals, it's a beautiful character. It's a beautiful person. It's fabulously entertaining to think about someone like that. I wouldn't have the energy to be like that for a whole life long. But some people seem to have a different metabolism, and they can produce that energy. It's fabulous. And then the sparkling fireworks like mind that comes up with ideas and situations and always finds some way, and there are these extraordinary and eccentric human beings, and really I'm grateful for every eccentric who still walks the face of the earth, because they're slowly vanishing, and they bring wonderful color to our lives.
So is that the fun of a role like this? Is that you get to?
Yeah, it's just marvelous, and it's so well written. And then to do that with Tim and Amy, in such a wonderful combination, and to work on it with freedom that they give you. And there was never anybody saying, "Oh no, you got to deliver and you got to do this." No, it was really a dream job and a wonderful time.
So was Tim mostly in terms of your figuring out your performance, a bit of hands off and
No, he's not hands off, but he doesn't interfere. He directs. Mm-hmm. And he doesn't tell you what to do. He tells you what he would like to see. And I appreciate it, because it puts the professional burden on me. That's what I do for a living. Mm-hmm. Translate that into action, as I like to say. And it's also communicating with Tim is fabulous, because you have to learn the language first. Mm-hmm. But once you speak it and you get a little fluent in it, it's... You have a conversation on, you talk to him, and it. Anyway, it's like
that's a pretty good Tim.
But you get to the point miraculously. It's just a whole different mode of communication.
So is that true with a lot of directors, or is this unique to Tim?
Yeah. Well, I mean, Tim speaks Timish, and the others speak theirs.
And Quentin has his own language also?
Yeah, no, Quentin is more analytical to the... just like anybody, you know, all real personalities have a very specific way of speaking and a very specific way of communicating. Because they have very specific stuff to communicate.
And is your role, I mean, do you see your role as an actor to, are you always in service to the director's vision? Or, I mean, obviously to some degree, but...
I don't know, I wouldn't call it in service, but I consider it to my advantage that I submit myself to it. Mm-hmm. Because I'm really after diversity, and I'm after... stuff that I'm not so familiar with, because I want to expand myself, and to kind of revert into the comfort zone all the time. You could do that, but I don't consider myself interesting enough to still be entertaining and within my comfort zone. So in a way, I'm always a little stressed out about being sufficient. That's true, but that's sort of just a personality thing. Mm-hmm. And handing myself in a way over to someone I trust and admire is a nice thing, because I don't feel I'm in danger, and I feel that I'm being helped along in my development, and that you might consider it manipulative, but I don't see it as such, you know, because I don't manipulate them into doing something to my benefit. Right. I just kind of go along with a new inspiration. Mm.
So each time you decide to do something, so Polanski, another major director that you worked with, is that part of the journey? I want to have the experience of a Polanski?
Well, yeah, it's part of the consideration. Can I do that? Would I do it? Would I still feel safe in a way in doing that? And will it really add to my growth, development?
Do you get a sense of that from a conversation or two, or do you know until you're actually on the set working?
Well, yeah, a conversation or two might not be enough, but in combination with the script and the work that you're asked to do, and there's a little risk involved. Yeah. Mm. And that's the beauty about the work that I do. If it goes wrong, you're not dead. Hmm. You don't really have to, you might, you know, your career might take a little dip or not, or, you know, that's something that I leave to others to decide. But you don't really, you can incorporate the experience, and you're not really harmed mentally or physically.
Have you had an experience where you came out of production and were actually kind of scared of what you did? did I go too far? Or did I not go?
Yeah. Yeah, or not enough. Or, as I said, I like to feel that it's not precise enough. It's not detailed enough. It's insufficient. When I've done too much, I kind of know. Mm-hmm. I have a pretty good... what do you call
radar
these?
Or
meter, yeah, but what do you call the instrument that measures?
Like a Geiger counter?
Geiger counter, or measures earthquakes, you know?
Yeah.
Whatever.
You can feel the ground moving.
Yeah, yeah, I can feel it.
You've gone so far.
Maybe we'll tone it down a little bit.
So, in this movie, encountering Amy's Margaret, did you guys have any chance? I gather Amy was didn't have a lot of time between shows to get, you know, to get rehearsal time in or whatever. But
we did a little bit. We did, and you have time while you're at it, you know. Mm-hmm. So you don't. It's not like in the theater where you rehearse and then it needs to stand and right. You do it. Even then, you rehearse to a certain level, and then you do the premiere, and then it still develops.
Right.
So with Amy and Tim and myself, it was a constant dynamic going on, and it developed. Yeah.
Is there a challenge to acting against somebody who's playing it so inside? It's such an introverted character.
I never play against anybody. I play with them.
Huh. Okay. So is it? I mean, is it? Is that a different kind of challenge to have some to have the person
yeah of course
trying to communicate with not really communicating
well that kind of is very analog to the story
and
is it a different challenge of course but it always is in whatever it is it that's what keeps it interesting
Walter kind of goes on his own steam anyway. He's on his own place. So what was...
He's got a lot of places.
Yes. Yeah. Well, so one of the interesting things about the movie is that there are moments of very of real darkness, he doesn't really end up being a villain.
I mean, thank you for saying that. I totally agree.
Well, I think that Margaret, at the end, still has love for him and still sees him as an important part of her life, even though...
Well, that's the if you want poignant aspect of this story, yeah. Almost tragic if you want that it did start out as a very genuine, emotional, and loving relationship, and it just went awry.
Well, went too well for him.
Well, yeah, no, and it's interesting to follow and identify and live with and experience what's going on that kind of pulled that relationship apart.
Mm. So she had Margaret. Did you go through tape of Walter? Did you get any Walter?
No.
At all?
No, and I feel extremely uncomfortable with doing that. You know, it puts me in a very uncomfortable and in a way, inhibitive situation, because I then feel responsible to do justice to a real person, and I always then feel that I'm, you know, cornered, because now I try to take responsibility for what the writers wrote. Mm. But if I then have, you know, through the writers writing the responsibility for a real person in real life and depicting a part of their life, I don't even know whether I infringe upon something that I cannot, you know, control. Mm-hmm. It has nothing to do with my intentions. And really, if you confront or infringe upon someone else's personal innermost life, you should at least be able to then be able to apologize for doing something wrong.
Yeah.
But, you know, if you can't do that, if you, as I said, can't take full responsibility for your action vis-a-vis that person, mm-hmm. I don't really know how to behave properly. Mm-hmm. And so I rather hide behind the writers and the script and the director and say, no, this is a movie, this is a fictional character. Mm-hmm. I do what an actor needs to do. Mm-hmm. And nothing more than that.
So do you have a process, particular process that you use when you get the script, when you decide you're going to do it, and you...
Reading. Reading.
Just read it.
Reading is a good thing. Reading the script.
Yes. But are you a big note taker? Are you a big detail person that way, or are you...
I'm a detail person. I'm not such a big note taker, because I take notes, but then the next day I look at these notes and I say, oh, who wrote that crap? You know, so I
So you want it to happen while you're on set doing the work?
No, it'll happen, you know, it's unavoidable that the head is going. And yes, I do take notes, but I don't find anything so noteworthy to really elaborate on it in writing. I write, but I try to find it in the script. And
so other research not that interesting to you? I mean, not,
it's very interesting.
Did you do the West, the Old West, when you did?
No, it's very interesting. And there's, I just don't really think that we're talking about science here. You know, where you apply scientific research method to approach the theory, to, you know, because it always, in the end, then you get into the situation where you find yourself trying to prove that it is right or wrong. Mm-hmm. I don't think anything is right or wrong. I think that you need to establish this flow, and you need to establish the firm footing from which you can then play. It's not called playing for nothing. Playing is a serious thing. If you watch children totally immersed in their playing, it's not something that needs to be or can be belittled. That right. is a reality. And they are fully immersed in that reality. Mm-hmm. And you cannot really penetrate. You can't pierce that bubble. I mean, unless you completely want to destroy that playing.
Right. Or it's time for dinner.
Well, I mean, you know the reaction.
Yeah.
They, without leaving that situation, they say, yeah.
And well, they want to hold their concentration, like an actor would, I guess. It's interesting, because, I mean, it's fascinating how many actors have different approaches, and yours is kind of what I would think of now as the Tilda school, because Tilda also talks about, when she talks about acting, she actually won't even accept the idea that she's acting. It's all, you know, she wants to be like a five-year-old or six-year-old playing. Yeah. That's what the goal is.
Yeah, really.
Is to never feel like you're working.
Yeah, and really, when you think back at yourself as a five- or six-year-old playing, and everything that happened after it, the rest feels like expulsion from paradise. Mm. That I mean, I ask friends, and from my own feeling, that is actually when they feel the most, and certainly I feel the most integrated and centered. Mm. When I remember how I played as a five-year-old, that was really me. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, all these things, you know, dinner, yeah, well, it's necessary, but school and, you know, peer pressure and media exposure and television and that, yeah, and then it's plucked apart. So really, you know, we need to collect the bits and pieces, put them carefully back together again.
Remove some of the intellectualization of everything, I guess.
Well, yeah, I mean, sooner or later, yeah, but in the development, the intellect kicks in to a degree where it then might take over. Mm. And that helps or assists the expulsion from paradise.
So in this 6 years, and you've now been immersed in Hollywood, you become you're not really a Hollywood guy, but you become part of the industry, really. I mean, you have three movies coming out this year, I believe, and four a few years ago, and you're very busy, you're very in it. Do you try not to consider all of that? Do you ever think, okay, here's my, I mean, career step or any of that kind of thing, or you just avoid
it? No, but you know what, I'm happy to say that I have wonderful people who became friends who guard over that in terms of career and mm-hmm. all that. So I can really say, no, this is what I want to do. This is really where I see advance in you know, all of what I'm interested in.
So you want to be moving forward. You're not, regardless of whether it's career or whatever it means.
No, I don't.
It's a feeling.
I don't want to get stuck in sort of a routine that I want to, you know, I want to get back to that five-year-old one day.
That includes not like forecasting things you might want to do. Say, you know, there's, okay, this kind of role, I want to do Shakespeare on stage. I want to do this, I want to do that. None of that is an issue for you except in the moment. Yeah?
Well, no. I've done my theater duty, I think. I've done enough for a lifetime. Mm. And I feel film was always my prime interest. It was always my focus and center of attention. And finally, I get to play with the cool kids, with the real, you know, masters. I want to learn.
And you can feel it as you do the work? When you're going to set with Quentin, or you're going to set with, you know,
yeah,
with,
well,
Amy, or with...
That's where the experience really makes itself felt. I can tell the difference.
You can really tell
the difference.
And you know, as you're going through a movie, that what's working and not, you get a sense, you really have a gut sense of how things are. Always.
Yeah, I do too.
No, you. I mean,
yeah. I mean, yes, I can, and I love it.
There's some people who don't. I mean, but
yeah. No, I can. I'm not talking about the success.
Right.
You know, I'm not talking about acceptance and box office and all that. I have no idea about that. But I can tell whether it works or not. I can tell whether it comes together or not. I can tell that we're working on something that the director will be able to put together in the editing room. I can tell that there's a spirit. I can tell that there is a personality to the film. I can tell that there are it turns into a story that's worthwhile telling or not.
Mm-hmm. And with Walter, what was the hardest thing to find in Walter for you?
The hardest thing to find was the balance, really. You know, where does it tip over the edge? Where does it get too much? It needs to be as much as possible. Where is that? Mm-hmm. What is possible? And that's why I always say working with Amy is a gift, because she tries with you. Mm. You can work it out with her. And you don't feel like you have to prove something or hold back, or it's safe, because she works the same way.
So did you feel the seismograph go off ever during the performance? Were you kind of...
Did I feel what?
The seismograph, which we...
Seismograph, yeah, thank you. That's the word, exactly, seismograph.
Did you ever have to, I've gone too far?
With a character like that, you need to try too much. Mm-hmm. And then I really sort of relied on Tim to tell me. Mm-hmm. I mean, the courtroom scene, you know, the real courtroom scene, mm-hmm. was infinitely more than, and most of all, longer, mm-hmm. than what we show. They had to really tone it down and bring it down to a believable amount, because the man was going berserk.
It has that bananas moment where the Woody Allen movie where he is interrogating himself.
Yeah, and but in the real courtroom in 63 in Honolulu, it must have been a circus.
It was, the guy, it's funny because a lot of the reviews have mentioned the judge, which is such a small part people wouldn't normally review, but he really is great.
Oh,
and it's
fantastic. He's absolutely fantastic. So that scene really revolves around him. Mm-hmm. And it's a beautiful, beautiful idea or way of telling that courtroom situation. That, yes, a real courtroom revolves around the judge, because the judge directs it. And he did that, so James, what a fabulous guy this is, yeah. Mm.
So when the movie's done and it's finally done, firstly, do you watch dailies or The Monitor or whatever?
No, neither.
Don't look at either?
No, I don't watch. I play.
So you're happy to see it when it's done?
Yeah.
And a lot of actors talk about having discomfort watching themselves. Do you have that, or are you watching the movie, able to watch the movie?
I don't know. I don't have discomfort. I actually have this odd objectivity to a degree, I'm sure, you know, but at least I perceive it as an odd objectivity, because I can say, okay, that went all right. That's not good. That's not good. That's not good. And I know why. I kind of, the things that are all right, I let pass, and I point my finger at the things that aren't. Mm-hmm. But I can argue with myself why, and I don't have to, you know, it's not like an emotional turmoil. I say, well, I did this and that and that and that. It doesn't work because.
So you're not nitpicking. You're looking at.
I am.
You are nitpicking.
Decidedly.
But you're not being unkind to yourself.
I'm realistic, but my realistic might sound unkind to you.
So do you get to enjoy the movie at some point? Does it ever become?
When I saw it for the first time, I really enjoyed it. And I really thought it's a great movie experience because it has all these elements of a full night out. It's enjoyment, laughs, serious engagement in a at times dark development and story, and it gives you a lot to think about. When you leave, it goes with you, but you feel good about having been there and seen it.
Well, it really is about more than the log line. I mean, you can't you kind of say what the Keens were, whatever. It's actually, there's something deeper going on that I think was captured by the actors and Tim and the screenplay and everything else. That, you know, the birth of feminism and the finding a voice and all of those things that you don't really realize until you've actually seen the movie.
Yeah, exactly. And that, I think, is the best a movie can do.
Hmm. What kind of movies do you like to see yourself? Do you go to movies a lot, or do you watch the screeners? Or
no, I like to go to the theaters. I don't know. It's the communal thing is one thing, but the fact that a screen is big, the room gets dark, and you made your way there, you paid your admission fee. And now you sit in one spot is part of the experience for me. Mm. The concentration, because that's what I came for. And I that's why I like to go to the movies. The best theatrical experiences I had, I always connect to movies that I've seen. Mm. I mean, I've seen some great theater, but the fullest engagement I always found in movies.
Well, there's something about sensory deprivation with movies that's not true in theater. You're always aware of the human beings in a theater, no matter how great they are.
It's always because I know what they go through. Mm. It always makes me feel uncomfortable.
So you see when you see a show, you're seeing all the stuff that's going on off stage and.
Yeah,
running to get the outfit changed.
Yeah. I'm always fidgeting. I know exactly what he feels. I know exactly what she's going through. I know exactly what's going on in there. Tension here and insecurity there, and it's all happening. And a lot of people think that's a great thing about going to the theater, but that's the painful thing for me.
And does working on a giant movie like you're about to work on, or you've worked on, I mean, what do we call it, was huge. Green Hornet got pretty big at some points, versus something like this, which is actually pretty down and dirty and one of Tim's lower budgeted movies. Mm. Is it a different experience? Or
it is a different experience, but ultimately what I personally do is not different. I still play the part.
So all that stuff around you is just
all that stuff around you, and that's another it's another aspect where experience comes in handy. That is like, yeah, okay, it's a bit bigger, it's more expensive, you know, yeah, fine. Can we make room because now I want to do what I do, and then when I'm done, you go and play again. But it's not that different for me.
And do you take away the memory of the work or? What comes out of the process? Or?
No, I usually take away the memory of the work. I usually take away very specific moments of when I did what, and you know, not all of them are lovely, joyful memories. But, you know, I remember a lot of painful and difficult moments, but it's really the immediate moments that I remember, and not so much when I see the movie. I see the movie like any movie, but the memories that I have are always related to working with the people in the moment.
Sounds like you're gonna have good memories from this one.
I do. In that respect, I do.
Excellent. Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Thanks very much.